Well, let's just go right into the word together after prayer. Father, we just thank you for your Holy Spirit leading, guiding, and directing us, assisting us in understanding of your word and getting out of it what needs to be had for us and each individual here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, if you recall, we left off, I believe, at the 29th verse in the first chapter, so we're going to pick it up right there. This is about Peter's mother-in-law. It starts out here. It says, "Now as soon as they had come out of the synagogue, they entered into the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John." Now, I like this right off the bat because we just got out of them coming out of the synagogue where they cast the devil out, and then, or Jesus did, you know, they were just apart. But they cast the devil out, and then in verse 29 it says, "As soon as they came out, they entered into the house of Simon, Andrew, and James." I'm sorry, of Simon and Andrew. Now, I thought that was interesting because we don't have much of a culture of sharing places and things with people. We're not a very sharing culture, if you're honest with one another. And in this case, it says that they were sharing with Peter and Andrew. Of course, then the mother-in-law's there, so I don't know about you, but have you ever had family stay for extended period of time at your house? It's kind of tense, you know? But this culture actually encourages and had folks staying with one another frequently and for, in this case, probably sharing everything together. But need I say more, honestly, I think it's a disadvantage for us as to have a culture of independence, which is what I consider us here. In our culture, I think it's a very independent culture, which makes it too easy for people to avoid conflict. They don't really know how to work their way through it. They just, if they get into conflict, you know, like your mother-in-law living in your house, that's pretty easy to have conflict with. Anybody living, your brother is there, and your mother-in-law lives there. Of course, you got your wife. So, I mean, there's already a bunch of stuff brewing there. And in this case, I think our culture, which is everybody gets out and gets on their own as quickly as they can, and everyone has, you know, what everyone needs for themselves. Like your neighbor, he has a lawnmower. You wouldn't probably even think of going to your neighbor and asking if you could use his lawnmower, even though you share pretty much a common lawn. You know, it's just not the thing we do.
Yeah.
But I think that independent culture also just makes it possible for people just to avoid having to interact with people and having to have discomfort. And I don't want to say it makes a bunch of whiny baby kind of people, but if everybody has their own thing and they're used to having everything their way, they do get a little upset when things aren't going their way. And when people who don't want to agree with this, everybody else or anyone else in this case, they might call that hate speech, which is pretty common these days, actually. It's people voicing their opinion, you know? But it's turned into hate speech because the culture has lent itself towards individuality.
Mm-hmm.
And so when that individuality comes into the culture, and I noticed that there are things in the scriptures here that I just noticed are very foreign to us. And I thought, it's good to look at that and see how important the scriptures tell us things that if we just take a minute, we can learn some stuff from. Let's look in the 30th verse. It says, Simon's wife's mother lay sick with a fever, and they told him about it at once. Now, other scriptures say immediately, which I thought was pretty awesome. Because if you just come out of that place where you saw a devil cast out in the synagogue, and you've been hearing this kingdom message, this is a new revolutionary,
Amen.
You know, kingdom message that is coming out of Jesus, and then we'll talk a little bit more about that in just a minute. But it says immediately. In other words, there was such a spirit of faith that was present with the disciples. They didn't even wait. They said, hey, here's somebody else who needs you. You know, needs a touch. Needs a part of the kingdom of God to manifest here. So they immediately took note of the situation and brought it to Jesus' attention. In verse, all joking aside, though, I mean, you got to know it's faith when you realize that, you know, it's your mother-in-law that you want to have prayed for, you know, instead of just saying, couldn't we just let her suffer a little longer? But Jesus said, you know, he's going to take care of business, and you knew that they were just right on the money when they didn't even pause to ask that question, right? And all the husbands said, amen. All right, verse. All right, verse, let's see, 32. At the evening when the sun had set, they brought to him all that were sick and those who were demon-possessed. Now, I could just imagine that, well, I skipped some, didn't I? I'm sorry.
31.
In verse 31, it says, he came in, he took her by the hand, and he lifted her up, and immediately the fever left, and she served them. Now, I think this is really interesting because a lot of people probably, this is my idea, is that if we have a plan for what we're going to do when we're healed, I believe that a lot more people would be healed. But instead, people are seeking healing. They don't have a plan for what they're going to do when they're healed. In this context, as soon as the mother-in-law got healed, it says she got up and she served. In other words, it was already in her heart to do that. She just was feeling so lousy. She couldn't do anything for anybody. I think that's a whole different attitude than when we come to God looking for healing. We're like, I want to get healed, and I don't really know what I'm going to do when I get healed. I don't know whether I'm going to go to the fair, or whether I'm going to go see a movie, or whether I'm going to go serve somebody. You know, but it seems to me that if you have a plan on what to do when you're healed, you're more likely to receive healing. Because you're in faith, you're making plans for something you have yet to have received. Isn't that right? And though it doesn't specifically mention that, I think that having a plan, that a person who gets up and serves upon being healed had that in their heart all along. And that it was most likely that people who already have a plan for what they'll do when they're healed, and it's not self-centered, you know, self-oriented, that they're more likely to receive. That's just my thought on that. In verse 32, we said, when the sun had set, they brought to him all that were sick and all those who were demon-possessed. Now, that's an interesting thing, because it's when the sun is setting, basically that's the end of the day. You know, most people are like chilling. They're ready to relax, right? And so, can you imagine, you know, you've had a day of proclaiming the gospel, you've been to the synagogue, you come over here, you're met with a need from Peter's mother-in-law, you know, minister to her. And then, you know, you guys might think that was a good ending to a beautiful day. Instead, just as you're just trying to relax, you start hearing commotion outside. And all the city crazies are coming to your house, acting crazy. I mean, that's a pretty weird thing. And of course, somehow, they're probably accompanied by people that says there were many sick. So they're not usually happy people either, and they're usually not alone. They've got to have somebody to bring them along. Now, if we took it to a real scenario, those people were probably not feeling well, achy, painy, grunty, groany, and then you got a crazy people all along the whole thing. I mean, this spectrum is really weird. You hear this all outside your front door. It says they brought them right to the door. And it says that the whole city, in verse 33, the whole city was gathered together at the door. Isn't that something? And then, verse 34. And I always ask myself, you know, would I open the door before I went on to the next one? I thought, would I open the door? Would you open the door? That's a good question, isn't it? I decided to answer that question. My answer was, I would always be willing to open the door. But I would need to know that it was God before I opened the door. And I think there's something to be said for that. I'm always willing to do what I think I've either seen in Scripture or I feel led to do in the past, but I'm going to check up at the moment and make sure we're still on track before I just throw open the door. Amen? So when you hear a bunch of nutty stuff, and I've had this happen before. I remember when I was in Bible school, just outside my apartment, there was some girl screaming, you know? And I heard a man's voice, and it didn't sound like it was going in a good direction. So first I just tried to roll over and say, they'll work it out. And then it didn't sound like it was working out too well for the girl, at least. So me and my 135 pounds squeezed out the door and said, is there something here that needs attention? And believe it or not, you know, when God's upon you, a lot, it's just one of those things where people just say, I'm really sorry. We were having an argument and it came out into the hallway here. I said, well, that, you know, I understand. I just want to be sure everything's okay. You know, and as long as God's on you, you know, you're probably not going to get a fistful in your face, but you want to know it's God. So before you open the door, just check. Even if you have past experiences, it might be good to check and make sure it's God. Amen?
Amen.
All right, verse 34. Let's see. Then he healed many who were sick and with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he did not allow the demons to speak because they knew him. Now, we talked about this last week. The things that it was one of the fill-in-the-blanks that we had, which is, you're supposed to say, if you come into a demonic experience, shut up and come out. There's really nothing else is necessary, right? Shut up and come out in Jesus' name. That's all. No conversations, you know, from whence have you come? You know, all these questions and all this stuff. Just shut up, come out in Jesus' name, right?
Amen.
And so here he does, sets us an example again. Prohibiting them to speak and casting them out. All right. You know, I want to say something about making sure that we're all on the same page here about casting out devils and healing sick. I want you to kind of go with me in the background to maybe even verse 15. It says, maybe 14 and 15. It says, now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. All right, so what was Jesus doing?
Preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God.
Saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent and believe in the gospel. All right, but then we see him going into the synagogue, we see people marveling, and then there's devils being cast out, and there's healings taking place. I just wanted you to see the order in which this happened, because it's very important we all get on the same page about why the supernatural is available to us. It's not a thrill ride for us as believers to go up and down the roller coaster of the gospel. It's really meant that we proclaim the constant of the gospel. The signs follow. They don't precede, they follow. Just so I could maybe refresh you on a little something, you know, Mark says later in the 16th chapter, they went everywhere preaching, the Lord working with them, confirming his word by the signs that accompanied it. So sometimes we, you know, even when we see somebody not well, we say, well, I'd like to pray for them. Well, that's a good thing, but if you really want signs and wonders to be a part of life, you have to remember the order in which they all are, which is good news first. In other words, sharing Jesus, the kingdom of God is here now, available to all.
Amen.
And the signs which accompany that message will follow. It's not the other way around, because a lot of times we're really like, well, I'd really like to pray for somebody, and if God heals them, that'll present a wonderful opportunity for me to share Christ. And you're like, yeah, that does sound good, but the problem is it's that scriptural. And I understand how things, it would seem so much easier that way. But it's not the way that it's presented throughout the scriptures to us as believers. So let's get back to the right order of things. Maybe we'll see better results if we do things the way that we've been told to and the way that Scripture admonishes. So, you know, I say why, Why do these things follow the gospel? Well, because if you're sharing that the kingdom of God is here, and the only evidence you have for it is that it's here inside of you, then that's really a step of faith, isn't it? It's a step of faith to tell somebody about a kingdom that they have yet to see any evidence of.
Amen.
And then, after you've told somebody about a kingdom that they have no other evidence for, God steps up to show them the kingdom that you've proclaimed that there was no other evidence for by giving evidence of the kingdom you just proclaimed. So you can see how it works from God's perspective, but from our perspective, we'd rather God just throw open the door, and then we can just present the gospel in a nicey-nicey kind of way that doesn't really require us to step out in faith and proclaim something that nobody else can see but us. Are you hearing me?
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, that didn't go over as well as I thought.
Amen.
Yes.
All right. So remember that casting out devils and healing the sick was a confirmation of the good news and of the kingdom of God in our midst.
Yes.
And when I say in our midst, I mean inside of us. You know, this is the evidence of the kingdom right here on the inside of me. And if nobody else can see it, it's only probably because we're not really proclaiming. Because if we proclaim it, God says he'll confirm it. Amen?
Amen.
That doesn't mean that, again, you've got to go buy yourself a bullhorn, get on a corner, and start proclaiming it that way. I'm simply saying, and we'll get into this, because we see a perfect example of it right here throughout these verses. So let's not go jump ahead of ourselves, but let's kind of take it the way it's given to us here in the scriptures. I think that if you look on your paper here, I think that's our first question. The Lord worked what?
With
according to what we said in Mark's 16th chapter. And again, same author, and he's just summing it up. In fact, a lot of these things that we, you know, that we're looking at, including this well-known, after the Great Commission, this well-known part of what I read about they preached everywhere and the Lord worked with them. It was Mark's commentary on the explosive actions that followed this Great Commission. And so his commentary on the explosive actions that followed this Great Commission was this: and they went out, preached everywhere, and the Lord worked through them. In one, our translation probably more often say with them, confirming his word by signs that accompanied it. Other translations say the Lord worked with them, confirming the word with signs following. Those are the blanks. So yours may say something slightly different depending on your version. All right. Verse 35. Here's the question I'd like to pose to us, knowing what we just heard and where we're going with this. My question is this: are you working for the Lord or with the Lord? Okay? Because this can become a Christian trap of sorts, where we work for the Lord instead of with the Lord. And we end up deciding what we will do and what we will not do, and how we will do it, and how God wants it done, and what would be most pleasing to him. When the reality is that, you know, if we go back to the book of Genesis, and we see that God gave a simple task to Adam, and then, of course, by proxy, Eve, which was that they would keep the garden, they would subdue its enemies, and they would keep the place maintained. But every day, God would come down and fellowship with them, maybe talk about how to do that. Maybe they could bounce some questions off of him. Maybe he would give them answers to the day's activities, or maybe they were looking ahead for the next day. We don't really know the scenario, but it does seem familiar to us that they would fellowship with God regularly. And to ask yourself why, out of our culture and the drive to make money and to achieve and all this stuff, and you have to ask yourself, what was your plan to begin with, is to gradually and over a literal eternity, get to know the God who created you. I know that it seems too simple. And yet, it is. And so, this has not changed. This plan of God's has not changed. That you would gradually and over eternity get to know Him. New birth was your entrance into this new life of experiencing Him, His presence, and gradually getting to know Him. Though you will never achieve finality, you will get to do this for eternity. And with it, we stack in all the stuff that we do every day and all the things we have to do. But here's my question. Are we working for the Lord or with the Lord? Because when we work for the Lord, we do a lot of stuff and we, you know, it's not bad stuff. It's good stuff. But my question is, were you created to work for the Lord or with the Lord? And this is part of the thing that happened here, is that it says the Lord worked with them, confirming His word with signs following. In other words, there had to be a continuity between the Lord, and has to be a continuity between the Lord and us, in order for us to both experience the kind of fruitfulness that we seek as believers, and to enjoy the time that we have, regardless of whether it's 100 years on planet Earth, or the 100 years plus the unlimited number of years that we have with Him. If we want to enjoy them, it's got to be with,
Amen.
Not
Amen.
For. And so I think it's nice to adopt this, and I see this as part of what's happening here. If you look with me in verse 35, it says, now again, this is after all the crazies show up at the house, right? And when you, I mean, forgive me, I have been in mental institutions a lot of my life. There are a lot of disturbed people. If you just go downtown in a certain time, in a certain place, and where they're all collectively mm-hmm. gathered and everything, and they're all talking, all at the same time, all saying nonsense, all bickering, all fighting, it's like a microcosm of Hades. It's just disturbing to observe. And yet, this is what happens. This is brought to His doorstep, along with a bunch of people who are moaning, crying, and need help. I don't know about you, but I'm like, lock the door! But you know, if here's the difference, that is me. That is me.
Yeah.
That is my reaction to that scenario. But picture me not being me. Picture me fellowshipping with God regularly, which does what? It changes me. So that I don't have preconceived notions about how I want and will do everything. I'm open to doing whatever. I just need a go-ahead from you, God, and a peace about pursuing. Not angsty. I'm not going to jump the gun. I've been in fellowship. And because of that, I'm ready even when I'm not. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
You know, I may not have it, but I got this. You know, it's a difference. And so here's where I think verse 35 puts it all back in balance and perspective. And it says, now in the morning, having risen a long while before the daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. So he's fellowshipping with God. You know, I used to have a picture in my room about, and it was Jesus praying, and there was this light that came down on him, and he was kneeling and holding his hands like this. And maybe you have that picture too. I'm not getting that picture here, you know. I'm seeing him just go out, go for a walk, be alone with God before anyone else can get to him. You know? And that's what I would call fellowshipping. Just like it was meant from the beginning. In the cool of the night, in this case, he went out early morning, and he spent time so that he would be ready. And instead of working for God, God and he could work together. And for all you theologians, yes, I know he is God. But just so we all understand, he laid aside that part that made him just like his Father's in power and majesty, so that we could see the Father through him.
Amen.
That's for the theologians.
Okay.
All right. Verse 36, let's look at this. It says here, and Simon, yeah.
Is this the fourth chapter?
We're still in the first.
The first.
Yeah, I wish we jumped that quickly, but we're here for now. And I may have to step up my game and learn how to go faster, but there's lots of stuff in between. It's fun to go through. All right, so that's a good question. Should be, yes. Thank you.
Okay.
Verse 36. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him. I like this. And they found him, and they said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." Now this is such a beautiful scenario, because here's Jesus. He's found a solitary place before anybody wakes up and before the sun itself is risen. He finds this solitary place so he can spend some time with God. And Peter's out there trying to kind of ruin it by pressuring him and telling him, "Everyone's looking for you." I mean, I'm sure you guys can get up in the morning. Remember when you had little kids, you know? And you're just waking up. You just want to say hello, Jesus, or something, anything, but be tapped on or pulled on by the little kids saying, "Mommy, Mommy, we need you," or "Daddy, Daddy, we need you," you know? And it's like, it's kind of that scenario here. Or maybe it's just your job, or maybe it's the text going off endlessly when you first wake up in the morning. And I know that you still got to take care of business and people need attention and so forth. But I think that there's a lesson to be learned here. So let me share that with you. Wouldn't it be nice if while everyone's looking for you, you were found looking for God? Wouldn't that be nice?
Mm-hmm.
And I think if everybody knows that's looking for you knows that you're looking for God, they'll chill out about looking for you. Because they'll recognize that the only way that you're you, and a good you, is when you're with God.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, verse, let's see. We have a problem, and that problem is that we have a God who we can't literally get enough of. I mean, you can't get enough of God. You could spend all day, and you could never get enough of God. So we have a problem, and that is that we have a God that we can't get enough of, and yet we spend so little time getting what we need the most, which is Him, right? So fellowship with the Father is an option, completely optional, but it is a very necessary one. And that's a strange thing for people to understand, because they think if something's optional, it must not be necessary. No, it's optional, but it's very necessary, isn't it? Anybody who gets in the flesh agrees with me. Isn't that right?
Yes.
It's optional, but it's necessary. So just because something's optional doesn't mean it's necessary. Verse 37, Peter puts the pressure on, and he says, "Everyone is looking for you. Sirens, red lights, everyone wants you." Isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
How many times you wake up in the morning and like your boss is calling, your husband's nagging you, everything's going on, you know, maybe I should say the other way around, guys, you know, your boss is on your case, and your wife is nagging you. I don't know, whichever way you want to look at it, but the idea here is that you wake up in the morning, everybody and everything wants a piece of you. Isn't that right? And in this case, Peter puts that pressure on. Jesus says, and this is astounding, because everyone, Peter's putting on pressure. He says, "Everyone is looking for you," in verse 37. In verse 38, what does Jesus say? He says, and he said to him, "Let us go into the next town, that I may preach there also, because my purpose is to come forth." What a letdown for Peter, isn't it? Peter was like, "Everyone's looking for you. We finally found you. Everybody wants a piece of you." And Jesus says, "Yeah, I think we're going to move on now." That was awesome. Wasn't that awesome? But how many know you can't really do that unless you're in a place with God? Because there's just too much pressure from people. And from, not that people are bad. It's just, that is what Romans 12 tells us. And I've got that as one of our questions here. It says, We will become, and this is kind of one of those words you can put on Facebook or Twitter or something, we will become what someone else wants us to be. And there's a question, there's two blanks there. Let me fill those in for you. It says, we will become what someone else wants us to be. And that will be either conformed or transformed. We will either be conformed or transformed. Okay? When we're with men and side with men, we become conformed. If we want to be transformed, we have to have been with God. Only God can transform us. So, and what I want you to understand, when I say we will become what someone else wants us to be, you're not hearing me, I bet. Because I'm telling you a fact. You will become what someone else wants you to be. That someone will either be man or God. You think you will become what you want to be, but you will not. You will become what somebody else wants you to be. You'll become a wife, you'll become a parent, you'll become all those things you think you chose, you watch. You will become what somebody else wants you to be in life. It is inevitable. But you can choose who that someone is. And that's a beautiful. So you can choose to be transformed instead of conformed. Because God alone is the only one who won't abuse you. He won't take advantage of you. He's not selfish. He doesn't have needs. And so he's the only one that you can trust, you can be transformed by instead of be conformed by. Amen? So that leads us to the last question. You will become what you surround yourself with. And that's a fact. You will become what you surround yourself with. And in this case, Jesus surrounded himself by fellowshipping with God. And you will become what you surround yourself with. He has a plan. God has a plan, and he will never exploit you. You can live out your destiny simply by fellowshipping with him. In other words, a daily fellowship with God will propel you into a destiny of his.
Yeah.
Instead of a conformity, you'll be propelled into a destiny. And you wonder, I mean, all of us have that question. God, how can I arrive at that place you want me to be? And I know it sounds so simple, and I know it's almost too elementary to wrap your head around. To say, fellowship with God on a daily basis. I mean, you don't have to sit there for hours, but I mean, make it a priority to get that peace that comes from fellowshipping with him. And that peace will propel you into a destiny. So that whether it's a crazy town full of nut job weirdos and sick people who show up at your door, or whether it's your family and friends making demands on you, or whether it's your best friend Peter who says, everybody's looking for you, you've got to go do what everybody needs you to do. And you say, well, I think we'll move on now. I mean, it's just, that takes God to be able to do that. I mean, some people, we reach the end of our rope and we're like, yeah, you do that because I'm not going to do that. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm just talking about not being conformed. Being transformed. And that comes when God brings us little tidbits of renewal to our otherwise old, moth-ridden mind.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? He opens up the closet, the moths fly out, and you're like, oh, I never thought about it that way. You know? And that's renewing your mind, you know? And it comes through not just, you know, the word as it's printed here, but it comes from the Holy Spirit illuminating harsh portions of this word as a word for you from him. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, that's good. I think it was closer to half an hour. Yeah. Get closer and closer.
Praise the Lord.
All right. Let's pray. Thank you, Father God, for your word this morning, and thank you for the way it changes us. How many of you just kind of, I want everybody to raise their hand and say, I want to be changed by God's word. And I thank you, Father, that you see every hand raised. I'm able to do it. But I thank you for every hand raised because I know that's really our hearts. We all want to be changed by your word, and I thank you, God, that what was of it, that was of you, and what was things your Holy Spirit wanted us to gravitate to and hold on to, that that's what you'll help us to. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, you got your questions answered there?
Yep.
All right. So you can go tell somebody, you will become what you surround yourself with.
You will become what you surround yourself with.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And that's in the context of fellowshipping with God.
Yeah, somebody said I'm a turkey.
I surround myself. No, they say it's hard to soar like eagles when you surround yourself with turkeys. Maybe they didn't say surround yourself with turkeys, but the idea is the same. But it is a law. You will become what you surround yourself with. And you cannot be in control. Others will control you. What goes on in your life can either be God or be man. And usually the devil through those people. Let's give thanks for the offering. Catherine, we missed you last week. You've been received this morning's offering, although we got somebody to step up and take your place for that. But you would be so kind.
You want me to pray?
Mm-hmm.
Father, we just praise you and thank you for your many blessings and for your love and mercy and goodness to us. And thank you that as we draw near to you, you draw near to us. And we just praise you and thank you for all that you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen.